Hi, everyone. My name is Loren Hammonds, senior programmer of Tribeca Film Festival, and I want to welcome you to this special edition of Tribeca Talks. Today's discussion is titled Represent, the Power of Being Seen. And we have three amazingly talented filmmakers whose work tackles the idea of representation for Black and Brown people on screen in remarkable ways in both narrative and nonfiction spaces. First up, we have Stefon Bristol, co-writer and director of the fantastic time travel drama See You Yesterday, which premiered at Tribeca in 2019 and is currently streaming on Netflix. Also joining us is author and filmmaker Raquel Cepeda, whose most recent film, La Madrina, The Savage Life of Lorine Padilla, paints a brilliant portrait of a remarkable Bronx Latina legend and was set to premiere at this year's edition of Tribeca prior to the pandemic. And our final guest today is Carlos Javier Ortiz, an author, photographer, filmmaker, and Guggenheim Fellow, whose work across mediums has been dedicated to presenting fully realized pictures of Black and Brown life, often profiling communities touched by gun violence, as in his powerful multimedia project, We All We Got. I'm so happy to have you all here today. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, of course. You know, for me, the importance for me, the importance of representation is twofold. It's crucial for the industry to recognize, of course, that Black and Brown stories can cover any genre and that there's nuance to our culture and to our lives that we simply don't often see through the lens of many established filmmakers with no ties to our communities. Also, we need to recognize our own need to be seen as something other than the sidekick or the ever popular magical Negro or just thug number three sometimes. I wanna start, before we dive into everything, I wanna start with this quote from a conversation between two white American critics, A.O. Scott and Manola Dargis of the New York Times. In 2016, they sat down kind of amidst the fallout of the Oscars So White controversy, and they sat down to talk about racial representation in film. And A.O. Scott said this, which I personally found on point. He said, the movies with Black protagonists that tend to win awards, to be legitimized, in other words, as mainstream, serious, and prestigious, are more often than not about exceptional figures, many of them drawn from the annals of American history, like athletes, musicians, leaders, people whose remarkable accomplishments both ease the consciences of white viewers and mask the collective struggles and communal experiences that sustain the heroes in their work. But even when those heroes are not historical people, they carry the burden of representativeness. And in the prestige movies that court critical and academy approval, Black people are often symbols and symptoms. Their stories, parables of pathology, striving, and redemption. These stories are frequently rousing, and the performances that anchor them are often full of rich feeling and complex humanity, but it's still the case that the focus is on the extreme and the exceptional and comes at the expense of the ordinary, which—
He forgot one thing.
What did he forget?
It has to center around the white savior.
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely.
If you're not saved by a white person, your humanity somehow is less valuable.
That part.
Less magical.
That is a major part. And that's actually something that Manola Dargis actually spoke on too. I'll give her quote a little bit later, but okay. let's talk about ourselves right now and the work that you all are doing that is really, really amazing in terms of the space of representation. So first to Stefon, your film See You Yesterday is anything but ordinary. It's extraordinary. Right, it has a teenage black female protagonist who is a scientific genius. And in the film, the premise is she invents a time machine and she's then forced to use it to travel back in time to prevent her brother from dying at the hands of the police. Let's look at a trailer before we go any further.
When we get this up and running, we gonna be out of here. Stanford, Morehouse, Spelman.
Hey, ring me along.
This is something Einstein spent his entire life trying to do.
We proved that time travel into the past is possible.
If we just give it some time.
It's scary, but you inspire me. You going places, CJ, and since Pops is gone, I gotta make sure that you get there.
I don't need you always playing big brother.
I'm the only big brother you've got.
NYPD, don't move!
Calvin Walker, a 19-year-old Black teen, was allegedly shot and killed by an NYPD officer. Walker was armed with nothing but a cell phone.
I'm so sorry about all of this. If I could go back and fix it, I would.
If we just go back, get them out of there, then he's saved.
We only have so many times to get this right. Everything's gonna need to be perfect.
What's today's date?
June 28th.
Sebastian, this has to work.
Oh! It's too late. It's about controlling something we obviously have no control over.
My brother didn't deserve this. Just miss him, y'all.
How many times have you jumped back, CJ? We're not superheroes.
Where is the justice?
We can't do this anymore.
We only have two jumps left.
Where is the justice for our sons and our daughters? When will it end for the whole nation?
You gotta listen to us. You're going to get killed.
On the ground! On the ground now! Get down!
So there's a lot to unpack there, but one of the things that was most interesting to me about this film is that it doesn't feel like it's designed to subvert expectations. It just instead presents an equally possible scenario within these genre conventions that the inventor of time travel doesn't look like a white man for once. So how much did that central decision inform kind of how you went about telling this story? And also, I'm really interested to find out how it informed the way that you got the film made as well.
There's no simple answer to your question, honestly, because growing up, I always loved sci-fi. I always loved action movies, and I always just want to see myself in it. You know, I want to see ourselves as heroes, as a scientist. Like almost every science fiction or superhero movie, the hero is a scientist, but white, which is fine. But I was like, man, you know, when I grew up watching Static Shock, I was like, man, that should be made to a movie. You know what I'm saying? Like, but because that cartoon and the comic by Dwayne McDuffie represented my culture, represented how we talked. You know, I grew up in Brooklyn. I grew up in Coney Island. You know, our lives is a little different from how a lot of, you know, young white protagonists are. You know, we didn't have the ET, you know, suburban family environment. You know, we had, you know, dangers of, you know, of New York. And, you know, we had the Bloods and Crips everywhere. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, what does that look like? My version of ET, what does that look like? My version of Back to the Future. And I was going through something very personal at that time when I was developing the script. And that personal issue was one of my family members was an alcoholic. So I was trying to make something about alcoholism within the Black family regarding the time travel. But I got rid of that storyline because, you know, it was that summer when Eric Garner got murdered. And it was still dealing with time travel. And I just could keep thinking, going back and back to how many times we see these images of young Black people getting murdered by police. Before that was Sean Bell, Amadou Diallo. Before that, you go way back to Emmett Till. And I just know that's going to happen again. And while I was writing the script and preparing for it, you got Freddie Gray that happened, you know, and then the Baltimore riots. So I always wanted to see what it is like to have a science fiction film with young Black teens with their perspective on life.
Because these films that we've seen in the past have really been one way and been such narrow visions, like, how did you go about getting this made? What was it that that allowed this to happen and be seen by a wider audience in this way?
I didn't expect this to be a studio film. It's, you know, even though it's independently made, it's made to a studio. I was not expecting or trying to do that. I was trying to make this very independently and very quietly, so it just blows up on people. And you know, granted, Spike Lee came on as my producer. But that's which is a big part of it. I'm not trying to sweep that under the rug. That's a huge mother effing part of it. But there's steps still need to be made. And that the biggest step was making a short film. I had to do the groundwork, make the short film first as a proof of concept. Because as a budding filmmaker, you need to prove yourself in the industry before anyone throws you money, obviously. And to build an audience off of that short film, you know, of course, I submitted Sundance, Tribeca, you know, Slam Dance, whatever, and I didn't get in. However, the biggest surprise of the biggest support that I got was through the Black film festivals. Mm-hmm. I was trying to find my audience that way, to people that who understood what I was trying to do, and then market through that to see how important it is and how much of an audience I get through these film festivals. These film festivals, you know, no diss to Tribeca, I love Tribeca, and you guys did amazing for me.
Yeah.
You know, but when I was trying to get in, I had to get support from the, I want to say smaller, but the lesser known film festivals who gave mm-hmm. me the most support. I'm talking about American Black Film Festival, Black Star.
Love Black Star. Love ABFF too. Yeah.
Yeah, and you know, it's because of those opportunities I met other producers and filmmakers and actors of all colors. You know, because this is a Black film festival, doesn't mean you know, folks are not welcome. Other folks are not welcome to go there. So I met so many producers who want to, you know, throw money at me, want to, you know, want to test themselves. I met so many actors that want to be part of it, and it's through that support, you know, I found what I needed. And I also accolades, and it's a great resume builder. So by the time I went out to pitch in Hollywood, Hollywood or go to LA, whatever, I had accolades with it. And what I tell them, like, my film is on HBO because of American Black Film Festival. I won an award from Martha's Vineyard African American Film Festival. It's like, oh, so this has merit.
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know, great. What I'm saying?
So you were able to build it up. And
exactly.
Representation for your own audiences, which I think is very important. Yes. And to have those gatekeepers that recognize the stories that you're trying to tell.
Yes.
So Raquel, just as Stefon's film challenges the narrative conventions that we're used to, your documentary, La Madrina, does something similar for nonfiction storytelling. And the film tells the story of Lorine Padilla, who was the first lady of legendary New York street gang, the Savage Skulls. And while we've seen the story of Savage Skulls in previous docs, and even thinly veiled versions popping up in narratives here and there, we've never seen a character like Lorene as a protagonist. You know, where she was formerly relegated to the sidelines, now she is front and center with all the facets of her complex personality on display. Let's take a look at the trailer for La Madrina, The Savage Life of Lorene Padilla.
You guys, by the way, are gonna be the first to see it because we just finished it.
Beautiful.
So the only people that see it is like my editor and like some other, so you're gonna see like, no, we're waiting for it to sell before we put it out. So you're gonna
I saw it this morning and I was like, yeah. It.
Just for you to know, I don't got no 2 million views, right? It's sold yet, okay.
Let's make that happen.
Yep. My mom always told me, you're gonna be a bitch because it was a bitch giving birth to you.
I always say I was born with gangsterism in my blood.
The streets became my home.
A minority group member in the South Bronx had a better chance of being killed in the Bronx than they did a combat unit in Vietnam.
I'm Lorene. I'm black as white.
When I became the press woman, I automatically became the first lady. I was in Rumble. I got arrested. I did some time in the name of the club. All the women there fought like dudes. It's really us, the women, that held it down.
How many here back in the days carried guns? Could you raise your hand?
You know, you have to look at where these kids come from. Just don't get up in the morning and say, this is what I'm going to do with my life. I'm going to land up in jail for the rest of my life. I'm going to shoot up drugs. No, I think I'll join a gang.
One day they had some kind of protest up Lexington Avenue, and I just joined.
It stirred an anger in me. It stirred activism.
2, 4, 6, 8. We the parents will not wait.
This is what was in the people's mind until I got hold of it. And I said, no, it doesn't have to be this way. We came out in masses, we voiced our opinion, and we refused to take it.
Don't let these dirty streets get you down. You can live in the ghetto, but don't let the ghetto live in you.
I couldn't sit there and not do something. I began to work with people that were involved.
Although she had her own children, she was everyone's mother.
It's a part of everyone's life.
The person that helped me out a lot was my godmother, my Aunt Lorraine.
And I never knew how strong you were. Because of you being my godmother, I need you in my life, Mom. This is why I fight with you.
So the first thing that I want to ask you is, did you know when you went, you know, when you set out to tell her story, like exactly how you wanted to present her to an audience that might not be familiar? Because she is an incredibly complex character and she's been through so many evolutions in her life that it's important to capture all of those things.
Yeah. I had an idea because I've always been as a you know, editor, you know, I used to be in the magazine world when that whole thing, when it was a thing, when I was writing as a journalist, when I was, you know, like all of the work that I've done, I've always been interested in identity and exploring, you know, people's lives and how people that are not even on the margins, they're on the fringe of the margins. How do they negotiate that liminality, that not being one thing or the other, not being enough to actually be seen as human. You know what I mean? Not even magical, because when do you see like a Dominican or a Puerto Rican or like a Caribbean Latino like woman? When you see Latinas, you see who? Penelope Cruz? She's from Spain, bro. She's not Latina. She's from fucking Spain. You know what I'm saying? Like, come on. So then, you know, like when it came to documentary, actually it was Brian Grazer who first told me I should get into film, even though I've always wanted to. I didn't think, I just didn't know where to start because there's no support. I'm not in a clique. There's no, you know, I didn't see any groups that actually I saw myself in that I can go and actually find communion mm-hmm. with, right? And build. But I've always wanted to make film. But Brian Grazer saw the magazine I was editing and said, you should go into film because you're very, you know, like the way you see things is very filmic. And I'm a writer. I thought I was going to be a writer first of, you know, I always wanted to be a ghostwriter for, you know, Rakim or MC Light when I was a kid. Then I said, this guy, I gotta make some money. But then I also want to tell stories and different stories. So I thought I'd be a film writer, but then I got really more interested in doing both, right? I don't care the way that I can, I don't care how I tell the story, I just want to tell it. Whether it's in a book format, podcast, film, I just want to tell it. When I met Lorene is somebody who people told me over the years, you guys should meet because you have a lot in common. And you know, she'd trust you because one thing about these insular communities, they have to really trust. They have that sense of that, you know, like when somebody's just trying to rip them off or try to steal their story, they have like a sense. And her being a woman, she has even a deeper sense of that and a spiritual woman. So it took me a year to just, you know, like talk to her, get to know her, have her read some of my work, have her read my book, for her to understand that I wasn't, you know, really, I'm not trying to like just show one side. Yes, you're tough, you're complicated. I don't want to like ascribe to the respectability politics that you see in so many films that are driven by Latino characters, Latinx characters. I wanted to make sure I would show the complex, the good, the bad, the ugly, and all everything in between in her life. So, you know, when we developed that relationship, she was like, you know what, fuck it, I trust you. And let's just go in. And then we just went in, you know, and I had to really spend a lot of time because it wasn't only her, it was other people that don't really trust people with cameras. You know?
Yeah. That's always the most important thing. And I think Carlos will probably second that when we get to talk about his work as well. I mean, I know on this one, you worked with Henry Chalfant as well.
Right. Henry. Yeah.
No, please.
Henry was the one who first told me I should meet her because he said something about you guys remind me of each other. Henry knew her. Like, you don't really see people in her position having home videos. But Henry happened to have that because he made a film called Flying Cutsleeves, which is like a real like cult classic about the gangs when they left that world. And she was in it because her ex-husband was such a big popular figure. He was like the crazy legs of the gang world or street family world, because he was everywhere, right? And he was just everywhere. So when I met her, it kind of clicked right away, you know, and that was that, but it was really him that made it happen. And he became a producer on this because Henry, if I've ever met an ally in my life on a personal and professional level, it's Henry Chalfant. And anybody who knows him will know that.
And just for the audience to know, you know, Henry Chalfant is probably best known as the producer of Star Wars, which is a seminal documentary of the hip hop culture. as it was being built. So all of the architects are profiled in that. And it's obvious that the trust was there for that in the same way that you were able to build trust with Lorene in this. And I think on that subject of kind of—
Can I add something? You know, the also about Lorene, right? She represents the women that raised me, right? I was not somebody who went to film school or to all the best schools. I didn't have like that kind of social capital. I was somebody who could have been like Lorene, right? Could have had that future. But I had women that were so, not stereotypes of hers, archetypes. Mm-hmm. You know, they're very archetypical. They're the mm-hmm. ones who like took me out of the street and really, you know, gave me a home when I didn't have one. So for me, it's like, even though, you know, I'm planning and I want to move into the narrative filmmaking space, there's always something always happens. And I'm like, I have to tell your story. I'm driven, I'm compelled. And I want to be able, you know, for people to see and meet the complicated women that raised me to create a complicated person today. You know what I mean? So I, you know, for me, that was an ode to her and to the women that raised me that were like her.
No doubt. So Carlos, your work also exists in the nonfiction space through maybe a slightly more experimental lens. I'm not sure exactly how you would classify it, you know, it finds you deeply embedded with your own community, your communities of color that have been affected by gun violence, poverty, and all of the other afflictions that unfortunately our people come up against. But you also capture the joys and the mundane moments that are not often, you know, that are often omitted when we see these families, right? And these normal moments just serve to humanize our friends, your subjects, in a way that many depictions of our communities just don't. Can you talk a little bit about kind of how you were able to establish trust in another community to be able to tell those stories and tell those personal stories?
You know, you go to Philly and you land in, you know, I landed in Camden, and I was like, the mayor was Black, you know, you had Black and Puerto Ricans living together, which is the same, especially in the East Coast. And man, it was just like, I was home, and it was just, like people just brought me to their crib, you know, and said, oh yeah, this is my family. It was like, people I just met on the street, I was taking pictures of them, you know, riding their bikes, and then they would bring me to their home, like right away. And so, yeah, it's just that door that's open, that people trust you with their stories, with their lives, with their families, you know, sit down and eat with them, you know, so. And that's universal, right? I think that's universal in Chicago, is universal in, you know, places like LA, San Francisco, Oakland, where I live part-time of the year. And it's universal in New York, you know, where Black and Brown communities exist.
For sure. This is a question for all of you. You know, as filmmakers, how much responsibility do you feel to appeal to audiences that resemble your on-screen characters versus, you know, trying to appeal to so-called general audiences?
You got to make the film for yourself, right? Right. Because you're always going to piss somebody off. You know that. Like, you guys know that. Somebody's always going to be mad. Somebody's always going to be, you know, you're never going to get it all the way right.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Sorry. No, I mean, for me, I feel that, like, you know, this medium is universal, right? It's universal in the sense that when you watch it in a theater or you watch it at home, but especially let's talk about a theater setting, you're almost forced to look at people, and so you're forced to look at a let's say, for example, our films, right? When they're in festivals or theaters, the audience is led to the community through our perspective. And that offers an opportunity, if you piss them off or don't, it offers an opportunity to really connect people to our understanding of our community, right?
Yeah. And you know, all jokes aside about pissing somebody off, you're always pissing somebody off. You know, like a lot of times some people in the community, because you hold up a mirror, if you hold the mirror up, sometimes you're not gonna like every aspect that you see. It frustrates you for whatever reason, right? And then at the same time, when you like you're showing these films to a general audience, they're going to be uncomfortable because of the roles that they play to reinforce where these communities are at that are on the margins, right? Mm-hmm. They're pushing them to the margins. So that's, you know, as far as documentary goes, you know, that's why I say, like, you just gotta, you know, as Jill Nelson would say, keep the faith and not the secrets, right? As long as you write and you approach your work with unclenched fists and an open heart, I feel like the people will come. You just Absolutely. Keep it real, the people mm-hmm. will come.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
For me, you know, I'm GT all the way. I'm from Guyana. My family's from Guyana. I'm a Yankee. I was born here. My family's from Guyana. and when, even though I'm Guyanese, I still had to do a lot of research. I had, you know, my thumb's in East Flatbush. I live in Crown Heights. I just, you know, I grew up going to Flatbush, going, you know, up and down. Vims, Bobby's, Sybil's, you know, eating the great food, you know what I'm saying? So, but there was a period when I felt, before I even get into the film, this period I felt like I was out of touch. Because remember, I'm American, you know what I'm saying? I went to Morehouse, where it's mostly predominantly American, Black American people. And even at Morehouse, I learned how diverse we are. You know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? You know, and I learned it's historically Black institution. So I learned that we don't all are Christian. We're not all are American. We're not all, you know, not all Muslims as well. So it's just different types of Black people. So I approached that to my film. It's like, I never seen Caribbean people on film before. Mm-hmm. And I was dying mm-hmm. to shoot that in Flatbush. Mm-hmm. So I felt, you know, I haven't been to Guyana for such a long time. So I felt like, oh, am I going to be an imposter mm-hmm. doing so? But that's my mm-hmm. heritage, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I want to represent that because I knew if I put up the Guyanese flag, which we call the Golden Arrowhead, if I knew I put that flag up, yo, mad Guyanese people are going to feel like they're like, oh, we represent it now.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? So it, you know, of course I pissed a lot of people off. It's exactly yeah,
you can't please everyone.
I you know, I got cussed out yeah. on Instagram, you know, the motherfucker, what the hell is this? And I have people who give me, you know, 2 pages of emails praising it, say, yo, I've never seen something like this. Thank you for doing this. Mm. This one of the most amazing. I've seen this film 5 times. I share with so many people. So it's both. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I've made some mistakes in my first feature film. And I'm gonna do everything I possibly can to do better.
No doubt. I mean, this brings me to this. I remember, Stefon, I told you last year during the premiere that I wish I had a film like this myself growing up. And in fact, I recently showed it to my son. He's 9 years old. And even though there are some adult themes in the film, he loved it. He was crazy about it. And particularly because I think so much of his brain has unfortunately been occupied by concerns of racism mm-hmm. and police violence. And to see this was really kind of, I think, cathartic for him in a way. And I wanted to talk to all of you as we wrap this conversation up and just see, can you each kind of share the first films that spoke to you in terms of representation where you really identified with what you were seeing on screen?
Spike's film, Love and Hate.
Do the right thing,
right? So like, you know, Stefan's talking about representation and we're talking about representation. You know, that was the first film, right? That American film that I remember watching that had all the flags of the Caribbean, you know, in it on that mural that I hope is still there. And you know, he, you know, had our sister, Puerto Rican sister.
Rosie Perez.
Rosie Perez, you know, and it was just like, I was just like, what's going on here? You know, like my people are here. So that was the first film that really had this large representation of the Black diaspora where I come from as a Puerto Rican and where we come from as Caribbeans. And then it's in this melting pot of America, in a neighborhood that carries all of us, right? And yeah, for me, that was the first film that really represented me. You know, and I appreciate it. So,
no doubt.
Yeah, and that influence is in my representation as a black brown person who identifies Latino, but I am black because that's my, you know, that's my mix, that's my blood, right? That's my hair, that's my lips, my eyes, and that's shown in you know, I basically want to see more of it, and I hope to be able to do that when you know, when I work. I'm working on a narrative film at the moment, encompassing these cultures that I'm influenced by and I grew up with.
That's great. Raquel?
For me too, and this is the reason why, for me too is Do the Right Thing, because for me, I just never saw life. I mean, I'm born in Harlem, but I was raised in DR and New York, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. So I understand, Stefon, when you're talking about like not being, in my words, not being Dominican enough, not being American enough, not being enough. You're always angering somebody, right? Over representation. And we're angering people over representation sometimes because there's so little of it, right? So they want to see everything. So sometimes I feel like it's with a good heart and I feel like it's well-intended, but you're just so excited about seeing, you know, finally yourself on the screen that you just like, if something is missing, you just go the fuck off, right? So for me, like, I love Do the Right Thing, and I actually set a narrative that I'm working on now in 89 because Do the Right Thing came out in 89, and it was such, I'm trying to find a word, somebody who has so many words. It was just so, for me, like,
artful home. Masterpiece. Yeah.
It was home. Like, I didn't grow up in Brooklyn. I didn't really like Brooklyn so much because I'm from uptown, right? So, but but I was just like, this is, you know, for me, it's like, Latino and African and Black Americans, Caribbean, to me is all the same diaspora. We're from the same well, the same spring. So it was just a natural, well-rounded story that was also not ascribing to the respectability politics of the day, right? And then later on, other films that I've seen myself in that I love are like Quilombo from Brazil. You know, I understand City of God, though I had a lot of problems with it. I understand that world, right? I said Quilombo, and I actually really liked, even though it was not at all about Black American or Latino life, I understood A Guide to Recognizing Your Saints, because we're from the same sort of generation, and I like the way, and I like the way he told a story about coming of age. That's kind of dark, which is where, and, you know, kind of the place that I come from, abuse and not like the musical side, like, you know, more of like the, you know, like the harder, edgier side of life, right? So I really like that, and I like how embryonic hip hop was in the way he didn't overstate, this is graffiti, so this is what we're gonna, this is hip hop, guys. You know, like, right. I like it when the shit is like natural, and I like quiet moments. I like long shots, quiet moments of just being, of just eating ice cream and frio frio in front of your building, and let that be a scene, bro. Like, why does it have to, you know, what I mean? Why does everything have to be so extreme? Right. So I like that. You know, I like that.
Absolutely. And Stefon.
You know, I'm going to go with this. Do the Right Thing.
It's a hat trick. It's a hat trick.
Oh, 120%. When I was 18 years old, but honestly, Do the Right Thing is not the only film that spoke to me, you know, as an artist, but Do the Right Thing was the film that made me want to become a filmmaker. I lived, you know, I moved out from from Brooklyn, you know, at a very young age, and went to Long Island. I hated Long Island, personally, not no disrespect to Long Island. And when I saw Do the Right Thing, it spoke to me about my childhood. And at the time, I was really being conscious of me being Black, and being Black in America. So that spoke to me that way. I really felt Mookie when he threw that trash can to the window, and I rushed to my mom and said, "Ma, I know exactly what I want to do." It's that night when I finished the movie. That night, I told my mom, I said, "Ma, I want to go to school to study to be a film director. I'm not paying you to go to school to study no film." No, she said, "Film." I said, "No film." And so, you know, but now she's my biggest fan. But before Do the Right Thing, other films really connected with me. That was, ironically, Jurassic Park, Back to the Future. Even though it was very white films, the magic of it connected me as to my imagination, because, you know,
yes, I'm
an imaginative person. So that felt part of me. But culturally Pacific, Coming to America.
Right.
That, my favorites.
One of my favorites. It was a great film. That was a great film. Yo, oh,
Coming
my God.
Coming to America, we, on my house, we just watched that almost every week. And me as a family, we would just, you know, we would, you know, quote all the jokes,
mm-hmm,
laugh at it. You know, we'd be on the train, you know, it's you know, making jokes about it. That was a magical.
Yeah, and those things are beautiful when creators can actually bring something that not just reminds you of your own family and your own experience, but then adds to it, where that becomes part of your inside jokes with your family and your friends and all those things. And I have to say, you, with the hat trick of Do the Right Thing, I am in the same boat as y'all. I do not think that I would be doing what I'm doing without that film and without the work of Spike Lee. I had seen School Days before in the theater. I was definitely too little to see it in the theater, but I was stuck. But when Do the Right Thing happened, that, I agree, that was something that just spoke to my soul in a way that I hadn't seen before.
Yeah.
Can I add a documentary? Because we talked about narrative film, but for me, the very, 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 very first time, the earliest memory that I remember seeing myself on screen was Star Wars. Was Star Wars. That was a PBS film. Mm-hmm. And I think it came out like in 83, 84. It's blurry to me, but in the early 80s, and I had moved back to New York in 81. So I remember seeing that and seeing, like, again, like what we were talking about before, like the diaspora, Black, Latino, people, you know, together and being part of this embryonic culture and very holistic culture that was hip hop. So it was not only about, as I'm sure you guys know, about rapping, emceeing, or the you know, spoken aspect of it, the rap, the singing aspect of it. It was about the visual and the style and just like, kind of like, you know, a very raw look at how Reaganism was like impacting mm-hmm. our communities. So that was a really, really important film for me too, in the documentary space.
Awesome.
And now I'm working with Henry.
I know, and Stefon's working with Spike. It's a beautiful thing. I could talk to you three for all day, honestly, but we do have to wrap it up. I wanna thank you all so much for being available and sharing all of these thoughts today. I also want to just remind people that, you know, we had asked in advance for you all to share something, because we want these conversations to be about more than just, you know, talking about the problems with the industry, and also give some solutions and give some opportunities that people might have. So we're going to have a little card with some of the suggestions, suggested reading and suggested films, and some of the films that we talked about during this conversation right after this. I want to thank you all once again so much for joining us, and we will see you again. Everybody go out and see these movies as soon as you can. All right, for Tribeca Talks, I'm Loren Hammonds. Thanks so much.
She's your queen to be.